Good morning. Okay. I basically am here to present the basic features of the standard fire policy and also tell you as to what you should avoid and what you should go with. Now, I have no doubt that in almost all the industries, trading organizations, establishments, and institutions, especially members of CII, now, you will be aware of this particular policy, standard fires and special payments insurance, issued by all general and or non-life insurance companies, as this would have been availed by you for coverage of your corporate assets. In addition, even the banks and financial institutions who extend loans to the corporate bodies have found this cover very friendly with, for their requirements, especially in line with their loan agreements that they have entered into with their borrowers. The focus of this presentation is primarily, one, the policy coverage under this particular policy, insurance policy, and what you need to note on. Now, as I've already mentioned, this is a very familiar insurance product as compared to all other insurance products available in the market. Not only does it offer comprehensive coverage for all industrial and trading assets, it also takes care of all the bank's requirements, and then it is time tested in that it has been acclaimed to be one of the better products evolved in the Indian insurance industry all time. Now, on the screen, you now see the basic covers that are offered under the insurance policy. The accidental contingencies such as fire and lightning, explosion, implosion, aircraft damage, and impact damage. Now, the first three are fairly self-explanatory. Aircraft damage is when aerial bodies fall onto your property and destruction is caused. Or it could be parts of them, it could be a damaged aircraft falling, it could be missile tests, etc. Similarly, impact damage is when third-party vehicles entering your premises accidentally come into contact with your buildings or your assets and they cause a loss which is covered under this policy. There could also be human intention, human peril, such as riot strikes and malicious damages or terrorism. Similarly, there can be perils of nature such as bushfire, landslide, subsidence, rock slides, earthquakes, which are also covered. Now, most of these policies or most of these covers are available by default as part of the basic standard fire and special perils insurance policy. Some of them, such as terrorism, earthquake, storms, typhoons, flood, inundation, commonly known as STFI perils, are available as part of add-on covers or extensions to the basic cover. Now, the exclusions under the fire policy normally fall into three categories. Excluded properties, such as bullion or unset precious stones worth more than 10,000 rupees in value. It could be curios, works of art, which exceed 10,000 again in value, manuscripts, plans, drawings, valuable documents, stamps, computer system records, explosives, securities, etc. It could also include boilers when the damage to the boiler is caused by an implosion or explosion because of its own pressure generating capacity. The excluded perils would include self-fermentation, natural heating, spontaneous combustion, or any other heating or drying process which is a part and parcel of the regular operation of the plant or that particular machinery. It could also be burning of property or destruction of property by a public authority or as per the law of the land. It also includes pollution or contamination that might be caused by the operation of an insured peril or otherwise. War and allied perils are also excluded. Similarly, it could be radiation, ionizing radiation, radiation activity, and nuclear perils. Excluded losses would be normal wear and tear, made up ground erosion, defective design, demolition or alteration by the insured themselves, excavation, etc. Another exclusion under this particular section would be the standard policy excess or deductible that is applied as part of the terms and conditions of the policy, which normally reads as 5% of the claim amount subject to a minimum of, this minimum amount being subject to the type of policy, type of industry, and the sum insured at that particular location in question. Expenses that might be incurred indirectly by loss of earnings could be loss of profit, or it could be additional expenses that might be incurred towards architects, surveyors, and consulting engineers' fees after the operation of a peril, which might, which is normally covered up to 3% of the claim amount, but if the actual amount that you incur is in excess of this 3%, then that again falls within your own part of expenses not covered under the policy. Similarly, alteration to buildings, sprinklers and construction defects. Now, when I say alteration to buildings, if you have insured your building and within that building you're making certain alterations and you have not notified the insurance company of the same, and any such loss that might occur because of such alteration or differential design that you might be making, which was not a part of the original building insured, will again be excluded, and all related damages will also be excluded because alterations are specifically excluded under the policy. And it is an industry expectation that the corporate customer be aware of the above exclusions to the coverage, and I mean they're supposed to know what was excluded, which normally, of course, as you might know, in more often than not, forms a part of the fine print which many people do not read. Now the add-on covers, as mentioned earlier, terrorism, storm, cyclone, flood and inundation, earthquake, impact damage by the insured's own vehicles or vehicles of the employees of the insured, and there are many other such, but I shall focus on these four particular add-ons because they are the most common requirements and they're most popular. Terrorism. Now, as far as the Indian Penal Code goes, terrorism is defined as any activity against public cause with a political motive without any profit motive involved, and it has to be committed by an organization classified as a terrorist organization under the Indian Penal Code. The government must have banned that organization. The state and central governments must have declared them as terrorist organizations. Now, what we noticed in insurance was that the police in any particular state or city were very reluctant to give an FIR stating that particular cause was an act of terrorism. Reason being, it would mean that there is a breakdown of law and order in that particular city or state, which then gives them a different kind of headache. So in order to address this gap, insurance defines terrorism as losses caused by riots attributable to religious, political, ideological and acts of similar nature intended towards striking fear into the heart of the general public or even an individual, an act committed by either an individual acting on his own or by a group of individuals acting with a common nature or common cause. So the with this description under insurance, what happens is the basic cover of riot, strikes and malicious damage, which is a part of the basic standard fire policy, is now negated to only stray acts of violence or random incidents which are not classified as a commonly motivated action. So by excluding this particular cover, one example would be tomorrow if there is a political riot because of the death of a political leader in your area, causing loss to your manufacturing unit, premises, assets, and you have not taken this extension, what happens is your insurance policy says you're not covered for it. So it is always preferable that you take both riot, strike and malicious damage part and the terrorism cover extension. Now this figures in this particular presentation because in most cases people think of terrorism only in terms of the global terrorism angle. They think of the additional premium payable towards this particular extension and consequently they lose out. Now the SDFI cover earlier used to be a part of the basic fire insurance policy itself, but off late it has been removed after these tsunami strikes and acts of other similar nature. It has been made a separate extension by itself. Now tsunami is a unique kind of a peril because it actually results from the operation of two separate perils, earthquake and flooding. Now if you were to take only the SDFI cover, earthquake is not covered, therefore your insurance policy will not respond to your requirement. You take only the earthquake cover and not the SDFI cover, so any losses caused by flooding or inundation will again be excluded. So these two have to be married together for you to actually have a comprehensive insurance cover. Similarly for earthquake, what happens is any such loss occurring from an indirect damage caused by an earthquake needs the earthquake extension, and therefore that too becomes a must as far as your insurance policy goes. Now I know that prior to the best example would be the 2004 tsunami, where until then, I mean, as a civil engineer and as an insurer, I've seen as far as Chennai goes, we would never cover for floods, we would never cover for earthquakes. In fact, as a civil engineer, we've not even designed for earthquakes as far as the southern zone goes. The Deccan Plateau was always said to be stable. And 2004, December, that big myth was busted. So now, moving on from the add-on covers, we come to the question of the assets to be covered. As far as the fire insurance policy goes, it is preferable to keep the description of the assets covered as generic as possible, such as buildings, which includes all civil constructions. Now, civil constructions would include all your building superstructures. They would include any ducts, security cabins, parking sheds, cycle sheds, any canals or other drainage systems that you might have incorporated towards drainage of rainwater. All concrete constructions come in as part of your civil constructions. And this will also include the plinth and foundation. Although the fire insurance policy gives you a different alternative as far as plinth and foundation goes, and I'll get back to that when I cover the sum insured under the policy. Now, again, when we talk of building, we're only talking of cost of construction and not the actual commercial cost. The commercial cost includes the profit margin you expect to make. It includes the value of the land, etc. Here we're talking only of the cost of construction. How much would it cost you to erect this building again, which is material cost, labor cost, and overheads. Machinery, all plant and machinery, any mechanical equipment that might be there in your premises, spares for those, stores for those, all of them can be classified under a single classification of plant and machinery or just machinery in general. Similarly, for furniture, fixtures, and fittings. Fittings can also be electrical fittings, which is the inherent wiring that comes with the building at the time of purchase of the building or at the time of construction of the building. Fixtures would be the doors, windows, glass fittings, etc. Everything that again is fitted as part of the building structure itself. Electrical installations, it has been specified separately because that would include any other separate installations that you've made in addition to the original wiring and other fittings that came when you got your building, which could be your lights, it could be special wiring, special equipment, fans, etc. Could be industrial fans, it could be air cooling systems. They can break out into this. Stocks would include raw material, work in process, finished goods, any kind of packing material that you might have stored for packing of finished goods and or work in process in case a job work unit is involved. It could also mean your marketing brochures, etc., which you use for promotion of your product, and any other stocks of any other nature. It could be stocks held in trust, which are not owned by you, but you're processing for another owner. And it could also mean stocks of yours, which are held in the job work premises and which are being processed there to be brought back for finalizing or finishing the goods. Anything else such as office equipment, electronic equipment, everything else can be brought under the scope of others. One thing to note is laptops and other equipment which do not have an address associated with them will not come under this particular policy. They have to be taken covered under a special policy. Everything that comes under the fire policy has to have an address associated with it. It has to be stationary at that particular address. It can move within the premises, but not outside the premises. I think I've already covered this. The broad classification is the most preferable. It is not necessary for you to give details of individual machinery along with serial number, make and manufacture as far as the fire policy goes. However, if you have multiple blocks in the same compound within the same premises, it is preferable that you give a block-wise description of the assets, as in plant and machinery blocking, electrical installation blocking, furniture fixtures blocking. The advantage is, in the event of a claim, if there is a fire in one particular block, the surveyor would expect you to furnish details of all assets in that particular block to substantiate that all the assets have been covered. Now, if you were to give a single value for everything, you will have to produce your entire asset register for the entire plant and substantiate it with values, invoices, etc. towards substantiating your claim, which might be not even a tenth of the total asset value in that unit. Similarly, as I've already mentioned, fixed electrical installations which came along with the building can be covered as part of machinery or building, or if you can provide a separate valuation, you can give them as electrical insulation itself. Again, it is a question of the ease of justifying your claim as and when it happens. Now, the valuation of the building. Valuation of the building can be done. The fire insurance policy basically provides for two types of valuation. One is market value, the other is reinstatement value. Market value, as you might be aware, is the value of the building, which is cost of construction, at present day cost, less depreciation for the age of the building and the condition of the building. Now, this is not a very beneficial thing, because what happens is the cost of construction that you might incur at the time of building this building might have been an entirely different amount as compared to the amount that you might incur today. So you will get hit with this, depreciation factor, plus if the value of insurance taken is not equal to the actual reinstatement value today, there can also be, or the depreciated value today, there will also be this factor of underinsurance which comes in. So your net realization under the policy will be much lesser than what you should actually get. Now, reinstatement value says that the cost of construction will be paid at the present day replacement cost, as in what it would cost you to actually reconstruct the building at its present location for present day cost to bring it back to the state it was just before the loss occurred. Now, there is no premium ramification as far as market value or reinstatement value policy goes. The premium charge is still the same. It is just a question of requesting the insurer to say, I need a reinstatement value policy or market value policy. Yes, the one disadvantage of a reinstatement policy is that settlement will be effected after completion of all repairs, which means you have to present the bills and collect your claim amount. Whereas market value is a cash settlement, and reinstatement value says you have to erect it in that same place, or with the permission of the insurer, you may erect it at a different place. But again, with the permission of the insurer, and there are time limits as to when you must complete it. Market value does not insist that you must reinstate your building. It just says this is what we adjust and this is the amount you're due for. You can collect the cash, and whether you rebuild your property or not is entirely up to you. So preferable thing to do would be is when you take this insurance policy, you take it on a reinstatement value basis. Tomorrow, if you wish to rebuild, what you do is you go for a reinstatement value settlement, which means you erect the building and then take a refund from the insurance company, which means you don't lose anything. And in case you have no desire to reinstate on that particular date, you can always ask the insurer to settle on a market value basis, which means the same rules are followed and you have no issues to face. This would be true in the case of machinery also. Oh, one thing I missed out was, in the case of reinstatement value, what happens is, if there are any repairs or replacements to be made, then in the case of buildings also, there is no depreciation or underinsurance applied. It is settled on the full value. Whereas in the case of market value basis, again, depreciation will be applied, even if it's a very partial, application of claim. The same thing applies for machinery also. Reinstatement value represents the present day cost of the machinery, and it is the actual cost of reinstating the machinery in the same place. I rephrase it. In the sense, if you have to erect a machinery and also erect some sort of a special foundation for it to withstand the vibrations of the machine, a reinstatement value policy will give you the cost of that fresh foundation plus the machine and the cost of actually installing it in the same place again. Whereas a market value policy will only pay you the replacement value of the machine, less depreciation in terms of age, its working condition, obsolescence, etc. And for all this, again, underinsurance comes into play. Now, the value for fixing, for fixing the value of machinery, one option is you get a supplier's quotation as on date of proposing the insurance, or you take the original invoice, purchase invoice for the machine, and you upload it with the inflationary basis or inflationary indices, such as RBI index or so. Now, a supplier's invoice might not be very easy for you to procure, in the sense that, especially in the case of equipment which are either obsolete or very old equipment, or where the technology has changed in such a way that the particular machine is no longer under production. I segregate obsolete and no longer under production because some equipment might still find spares and parts in the market. Some equipment are just not supported at all. So in such cases, you will not be able to find a person to give you values. So the other option is you get a professional valuer and have them value your assets. And one other alternative you can do is, where you have fresh machinery as well as old or obsolete machines, what you can do is have an agreement with the insurance company that the fresh machines or the new machines will be covered for their actual value, the reinstatement value itself. And whereas the obsolete machines can be covered for an agreed value with the insurance company, which means in the event of a claim, you will be paid the value agreed upon at the time of inception of policy without any dispute as to whether underinsurance is applicable or whether any other depreciation is applicable. The same logic holds true for furniture also. Now, in case of furniture, again, in the case of ancient or antique furniture, you might have a slight difference in application, because if I were to talk only about the reinstatement value, it's just a piece of wood which you're going to replace. But then if you're talking about some old teak furniture, there's a whole lot of sentimental value that is also attached to it. So it might be preferable that in the case of such ancient furniture, you go for an agreed value basis rather than, you know, reinstatement value or market value. Because old furniture will not have a market value that actually is close to the actual value of what you would get if you were to auction these. Stocks. In the case of stocks, I think the slide is fairly self-evident. It is cost of purchase plus incidentals such as transportation costs and overheads for the case of, cost of raw materials. In the cost of stocks in process, it is cost of raw material plus processing costs. In the case of finished products, it is raw material plus labor plus process costs plus overheads. Only thing excluded is the profit margin. Now, one thing to be noticed is if you have an export-oriented unit or export-oriented warehouse, there, what happens is that the duty component would not have been paid as long as the stock is still within that bonded warehouse. The duty component is payable only after you remove it from the warehouse. Now, if something were to happen to that stock when it is in the warehouse, the company is still liable to pay duty to the government. So when insuring such stocks, it should be noted that the stock of cost of raw materials has to include the duty factor also, because the insurance policy will also pay that as a part of the total cost of the stocks. And in the case of stocks, there is no question of underinsurance or depreciation that is applied. It is a declared value of stocks. Now, this slide is actually one of my most favorite ones. It's only a singular slide, but this is probably the most comprehensive feature of an insurance policy. Most people have heard of this. Most people have probably taken a look at it. Nobody fills up one. Because administratively, people say that the proposal form doesn't really make any, you know, good work. Unfortunately, this is the biggest defense any company has when evaluating the insurance policy's accuracy or in the event of a claim, disputing their policy with the insurance company. It serves to convey details of the assets. It serves to convey the accuracy of the values, details of locations covered, and the coverage requirements of the insurance or the insured, you. Now, every publicity material or brochure of insurance companies as published mentions insurance is the subject matter of solicitation. It is to be understood, for all practical purposes, the general insurance contracts are to be termed as unilateral contracts. The term of the contract is designed by the insurer, and based on that, the policy documents are issued. And such policy documents do not bear the signature of the policyholder, despite the fact that he is one of the parties to the contract. Now, given that this is the case, it is absolutely necessary that the requirements of the proposer towards insurance coverage be made explicitly clear to the insurer at the time of placement of policy itself. A written proposal form is the only thing, a written, signed and stamped proposal form is the only medium that actually conveys the exact intent and interest of the customer to the insurance company. Now, similarly, any errors in the insurance policy, again, can be corrected only if you have submitted this proposal form. Significance is to be understood that for the policy document to incorporate the coverage to match with the requirements of your proposer, you have to make your requirements very clear, lest in the event of a claim at a later date, you will not have a recourse to fight it out because there is no evidence as to what you wanted. And especially so if you've not disputed the coverage in the policy, post the occurrence of a claim, you will not be able to do it. I can actually relate to you one example from my very recent experience. There is this works of art company which had its insurance placed through a bank. Bank acted as a bank assurance agent and placed it with the insurance company. Unfortunately, while giving description of the stocks, they specified only one particular type of stock, which comprised of only 2% of the total stock value of that company. 98% was not mentioned at all. In the event of a claim, I mean, the claim actually came. This was by the cyclone Thane. The claim amount was close to 20 lakhs. Surveyors adjusted for 1 lakh. And they said, this is all your policy covers. Luckily for the customer, because this was a bank assurance claim, they got together with the insurer. They did some backdated endorsements, a whole lot of, you know, reject works. And finally, this customer managed to get about 75% of his value. Still not the full value, but only 75%. But the entire process, which should have been settled within a month, took more than a year. You had to get these special approvals from the head offices of each company. Everyone had to, you know, agree to it, so on and so forth. You're just prolonging your pain. Again, the other problem with the proposal form is, especially where there are intermediaries involved, be it brokers or agents, the market tendency is to say, sir, we'll take care of it. Okay, in the event of a non-submission of a proposal form, one option that you can do is give a detailed statement of your assets and your requirements on your own letterhead, maybe not the insurance company's proposal form, but on your letterhead to the insurer saying, this is what I want. And as soon as you receive the policy, compare the two to find out whether they're equal or are representing the same interest. Another alternative, if you have an intermediary, is the broking slip, which the broker would raise against the insurance company. Any one of these, as long as they indicate that they represent your requirements, can be used in a court of law in the event of a claim going to a court and the amount of claim being disputed by the insurer. Now, there is also a practice where, in the absence of a proposal form, the insurance policy does contain a provision that the insurance company is supposed to notify the customer after issuance of the policy document that if any discrepancies are noted, they are to be notified within 15 days from the date of issuance of the policy for the necessary corrections to be made. But this again is a part of the policy wordings that not many people actually go through it. So it is my personal and strong view that the companies, at least the members of CII, make it a point to communicate their specific requirements as regards the coverage components. And under the standard fire and special perils policy, very clear, as I mentioned, by submitting through them a formal proposal form of the insurer in the form of a written letter having all the details required, or ensuring that the intermediary submits a comprehensive broking slip. Now, in fact, I have also come through these cases where there was a broking slip, the comprehensive nature of the details provided was not so very accurate. So what happened was what the customer wanted was not reflected in the policy. Although what the broker gave was reflected in the policy, on a physical inspection of the units, it was seen that the insurance policy had nothing to do with the actual requirement of the customer. And the biggest problem in today's market is the first reaction from any customer when we talk of a proposal form or going through the formal practice of placement of insurance is their reaction, I've never had a claim in the past 10 years, so why would I worry about it now? They're more worried about the premium discount. But no one can give me a guarantee that that which did not happen in the past 10, 15 years will not happen in the upcoming next year. I mean, if it's a simple logic, if everyone is very sure that there is never going to be a claim, the customer will not take insurance. If the customer is very sure that there will be a claim, the insurance company is not going to issue a policy. It is only as long as this discrepancy, this gap between the two extremes exists, that we need this insurance policy. And if we are going to act in such a way that we are not ensuring that our interests are covered, we are still in the same position as if uninsured. Now, this is another aspect which has to be taken care of. In the event of a claim, the first thing to do is notify the insurer and insist on an immediate survey. Even in cases where access to the location is very difficult and the survey might get delayed, intimation should be immediate. It is also required that, and it is a condition of the policy, that the insured, the company, the corporate, act as though uninsured towards trying to save their assets, towards minimizing the loss. So it does not mean that unless the surveyor comes, you will not even touch your property. If you can save your property, you're expected to save it. And the surveyors are supposed to give due respect to that particular aspect while evaluating the claim. Now, the surveyor has a whole lot of responsibilities. They're supposed to assess the loss. They're supposed to analyze the cause of loss. They're supposed to advise the customer, which in this case would be you, as to how to minimize the loss, how to get salvage, how to protect the assets from further damage. But in many cases, it doesn't happen. Now, again, in case there is a dispute with the surveyor's assessment, the customer still has the recourse to take the matter before the insurance company and take it forward. There can always be a tripartite discussion before the survey report is finalized, and it is your right to demand a copy of the survey report as and when it is issued to know what exactly is there. In many cases, what happens is survey report is given only to the insurance company and the customer is often clueless as to what was included and what was excluded. Now, it is also another requirement as per the IRDA regulations go that a surveyor has to submit his report within 30 days of the survey, actual survey done. And that only in exceptional cases can this time limit be waived. But practically, what happens is the surveyor can always defer issuance of the report citing want of documents. And this game goes on and on. It is actually absolutely necessary that in order that the surveyor does his job well and a proper assessment of the loss is made, the company will have to cooperate with the surveyor in supplying to him all supporting details and documents without any hesitation. At the same time, there is no need to come for the company to furnish just about every detail or document which are unrelated to the loss and the assessment of loss. I mean, to put it in a different way, honesty is a very good policy, but too much of honesty and transparency can also lead you to trouble. In fact, there is another clause in the standard fire and special perils policy, which can be an irritant in many cases, especially for the insured or the customer, in case the survey and assessment of loss or disposal of claim by the insurers is delayed for any reason beyond 12 months. The exact clause reads as, in no case whatsoever shall the company be liable for any loss or damage after the expiry of 12 months from the happening of loss or damage, unless the claim is subject of pending action or arbitration, this being expressly agreed and declared that if the company shall disclaim liability for the claim hereunder, and such claim shall not, within 12 calendar months from the date of the disclaimer, have been made the subject matter of a suit in a court of law, then the claim shall be deemed to have been withdrawn or abandoned. Which means if there is a delay in submission of documents from the customer's end, post 12 months, without any dispute being in pendency, the insurance company can very well reject your claim and you will not have any recourse at all. Now, this clause that I just read out, the legal validity is still being disputed. There have been judgments that go on both sides of the table. In some cases, the courts have decided that it should be read in favor of the customer. In some cases, they've read it in favor of the insurance company. But it still remains a part of the policy and therefore it is still a legal binding clause attaching to the insurance contract. So, in order that they do not have to go through this hassle of trying to figure out whether this clause will be of assistance to them or not at a later date, it is preferable for the company to not ignore this clause and ensure that no opportunity is given to the insurers to resort to this clause for repudiating a claim which might otherwise be admissible as part of the policy provisions in full. Now, in many cases, what happens is surveyors and or insurers claim that given that the insurance company pays the surveyor, they have an exclusive contract with the surveying company, which is actually not true. They are an independent agency and it is as per the laws of the land that they're getting paid by the insurance company, but they're supposed to be an independent assessment only, which means if the survey report is entirely biased towards the insurer, the customer has the right to demand the appointment of another surveyor and to redo the process entirely. The other points I think I've already addressed a little earlier, but to be fair to the surveyors, in many cases, it is delay in submission of documents that always leads to a delay in the claim and hurt feelings on all sides. Surveyor, again, this is only recommendatory in nature. In fact, as per the laws or regulations pertaining to surveyors, they can only assess the loss and state what is the extent of loss sustained by the customer. They're not supposed to recommend the value for settlement. A lot of people still do that. But as per the rules, they're not supposed to recommend a value. They cannot say that this is all that is payable. They can only say this is the extent of loss. The final decision of payment of actual quantum can be higher than this amount, can be lower than this amount, and that is entirely at the discretion of the insurance company. If there is a dispute in quantum, as in if the claim has been admitted under the policy and there is a dispute only in the amount to be settled, the case can always be referred to arbitration. And again, there are court rulings, etc., that says if there is unjustified delay in the settlement of a claim, the customer is due for interest, which is supposed to be payable at RBI or the standard RBI interest rate plus 2%. So this is again something that not many people know about. Okay, this is just a basic summary of what has already been addressed earlier. It is a comprehensive policy which has actually been structured much better than most of the other policies in the market. And many people, most corporates have this policy, except they've not customized it to their requirements. Settlement of claims, equal liability and equal responsibility rests with both the insurers and the insured and the surveyor to a lesser extent. And this, I mean, if you're a part of a bank, then this policy addresses, especially with the agreed bank clause, this policy really gives a lot of rights and control to the bank to ensure that their loan amounts are secure. This is the basic tenet, you can say. Asset details have to be clarified in a clear and specific manner so that there is no ambiguity in the policy document or while settlement of a claim or assessing a claim. Clarity on what extensions are required, clarity on what kind of a policy is desired. I mean, there are different industries that require different extensions. It is very much advisable that it is assessed, the insured gets to know what the additional perils available are, addressed to see whether it is actually applicable to them, and then decide on what they want in their policies. Similarly, the sum insured, if you want a reinstatement value policy, make sure that your policy has that particular clause in it. Because even if you have insured it for a reinstatement value basis and the policy is not subject to the clause, adjustment will be only market value basis, which means you would have paid a higher premium for a lesser benefit. And similarly, compliance issues is always documentary issues, ensuring that all documents such as claim form, claim bill, complete set of invoices, repair bills, etc. are provided for every claim made so that the surveyor can also assess the claim faster and take it forward. Best thing to do, especially when it comes to reinstatement value, is appoint a professional surveyor, professional valuer, have your assets valued, and ensure that the policy is taken for that particular value. And a surveyor might come of assistance too in assessing the risk of premises, and assessing the risk exposure, and advising you on how to save your assets better with or without insurance. And with that, I think I'll conclude. I'll wait for the question answers.